Good day. I'm Norman Wildberger, and today we're going to look at reflections in much the same way as we talked about rotations in the last video. Intuitively, the idea of a reflection is pretty simple. We have a line, say this line L, and what we mean by a reflection is we have a point on one side and we're thinking of the mirror image on the other side. What does it mean? Well, it means we go perpendicularly towards the line and then we go an equal amount to the other side. So A goes to A prime, B, say, goes to B prime, a little circle like this goes to a little circle like that, and so on. That's the reflection in the line L. That's a physical or geometrical description. Now we want something a little bit more formal. The usual idea is to work in the functional notation that's common in modern mathematics, where we say that the reflection sigma is a function or map from the real plane to the real plane. And then there's some additional geometrical description that specifies what kind of a function it is. We're not going to use that approach for a number of very good reasons. First of all, we have not yet defined the real numbers. Okay. Secondly, we do not believe in infinite sets, so we do not believe that the real plane is a mathematical object that's properly defined. And thirdly, the geometrical description, we want to replace it with something that's more concrete and more algebraic so that even a computer can understand what's going on. Even a computer with no geometrical intuition or no visual understanding. Okay, so how are we going to do that? Well, the idea is to simplify the issue by concentrating on vectors rather than on points. Reflections act on vectors in a unique and well-defined way, and it turns out to be simpler to think about what it does on vectors rather than what it does on points. So we have to turn our attention from the grid plane that we're picturing here to the vector plane where we're representing vectors. So here's our picture of the vector plane. A position in this vector plane denotes not a point, but a vector. So this position is encoding the vector that's emanating from the origin to that position. So here we have the vector 1, 0. Here the vector 0, 1. And we're looking at a particular reflection, the reflection in this red line here. We're calling that reflection sigma. We want to understand precisely what this reflection does in order to define it. So we're using our geometrical intuition to get an algebraic formula, and then that algebraic formula is what we're going to use to define what we actually mean by the reflection. So this is all preliminary to setting up the definition. So let's suppose that our reflection in this line sends the vector 1, 0 to an arbitrary vector AB. A reflection is going to maintain lengths or maintain quadrances, so that new vector is also going to lie on the unit circle. Let's call that arbitrary point AB. Okay, so that vector is going to go to a vector AB, and the other vector 0, 1 is going to go to a vector like this, which is going to be perpendicular to the vector AB, and it's going to be the vector B minus A. These two vectors are perpendicular. And now we can use that to describe what happens to a general vector, say xy. This particular vector xy is 2 times 1, 0 plus 0, 1. So its image under the reflection can be obtained by taking 2 times this vector and adding this vector. So we're going up here 2 times and then adding, there's the image x prime y prime, the reflection of the vector xy. And so in general, we're just going to do the algebraic version of that. The vector 1, 0 was sent to the vector AB. Vector 0, 1 is sent to vector B minus A. A general vector XY can be written as a combination. X times 1, 0 plus Y times 0, 1. It's called a linear combination of vectors. And if we know where 1, 0 goes, and if we know where 0, 1 goes, then XY is going to be sent to a new vector x prime y prime, which is x times AB plus y times B minus A. These are the images of these two vectors under this reflection. We work this out. This is ax plus yb, or by, there's the x-coordinate. And the y-coordinate is bx minus ay right there. It's very much like the formula for a rotation that we saw in the last video, except that there's a plus sign here and a minus sign here, and in the previous one, there was a minus sign here and a plus sign here. So now we can define what a reflection is. A reflection is a symbol. We'll use sigma, the Greek letter sigma, and with a subscript AB because it's specified or determined by that vector AB, the image of 1, 0. And we say that this symbol interacts with the symbol for a vector. So XY times this symbol, that combination, is by definition this, what we've just obtained over here. It's the new vector AX plus BY, BX minus AY. So we're defining this expression and how it interacts with the expression for a vector to obtain a new vector. That gives us a new mathematical object called a vector reflection, maybe VREF for short. And it's indexed or parameterized or labeled by a vector AB which lies on the unit circle. Now, just as in our previous video, I remind you that if a vector AB lies on the unit circle, then it's either the special vector minus 1, 0, or it has this expression in terms of a parameter t. And we called this vector V sub t. And I also remind you that in the previous video, we established this formula for a rotation. XY followed by the rotation index by AB was this particular combination. Okay, so now it's an interesting exercise to show that if you start with a vector XY and you apply a reflection indexed by this vector VT, you get another vector, and then you perform another reflection, say in the vector VU, where U is another parameter, then the vector that you're going to get can also be written as XY followed by the rotation indexed by VW. In other words, exactly this kind of rotation up here, where the W depends on T and U by this formula here. W equals U minus T divided by 1 plus T times U. So the product of two reflections is a rotation. We can just write that like this. So it's an excellent exercise, and there's a few things to be said about it. First of all, it's a little bit different from the corresponding result for rotations in that this is no longer commutative. If you interchange u and t, the order of u and t, then this changes just a little bit. It changes because there's going to be a minus sign introduced. So it's not the same. If you change the order of the reflections, the rotation you get is different. Another remark to make is that there's a little bit of a problem with this formula when t times u equals minus 1. Since t and u are arbitrary rational numbers, that can happen, and that means that there's some slight difficulty that can occur with this formula, and that also happened in the previous video. That suggests that we haven't quite understood this in the best or the right way. And in fact, we are going to later on understand how to go beyond this to a better understanding. But this is a very good starting point for understanding rotations and reflections. Another point is that we haven't yet connected the parameter AB, the point or vector on the unit circle, to the actual line that we were reflecting in. That's another very interesting point that we'll study, that will lead us to many more important understandings. Next time, we are going to talk about one of the traditional weaknesses of modern mathematics. That's closely related to the idea of rotations and reflections. It has to do with the notion of angle, which is actually a very, very problematic historical difficulty in mathematics. I hope you're going to join me for that. I'm Norman Wildberger. Thanks for listening.